May the inside free, outside free piece of peace that is neither within you nor outside of you be upon you. May the inside outside free security that is neither within you nor outside of you be upon you. May the inside free, outside free beauty that is neither inside you or outside of you be upon you. Welcome to the video. This is the double emphasis form, which actually I used it yesterday for the first time, and I found it to be incredibly effective, or may have been 2 days ago. Incredibly effective. In fact, so effective that I kind of panicked. I said, whoa, wait a minute. This is like, I'm here, you know, whoa. So I panicked a little bit yesterday, and I said, and I retreated. So I just noticed how I retreat. Whenever you retreat, it's important just to be aware, and you're kind of aware that you've gone back to the ego, saying, ego, protect me, the continuity problem. So we start out today, we say, I have a severe continuity problem, very severe. And at all times, I have to be aware of that. I have a severe continuity problem. That's the only problem that I have. That's the only problem that I have. And the vision of oneness is the ultimate cure for the continuity problem. So I need to align my valuing with the vision of oneness, because you perceive what you value. You go towards what you value. If you don't value it, you won't see it, and you won't go towards it, obviously. So I have a severe continuity problem, and that's the only problem that I have. So yesterday I was bitten by the continuity problem. So what I did was I went back, and what happens when you get bit? What happened in doing the double emphasis spiritual practice technique the Holy Spirit suggested to use is it somehow was knocked the ego out. The ego went asleep or something. And I was looking at the banner on the website with Raman Maharshi, Jesus Christ, and Sri Anand Mayama, and all of them are just radiating this incredible bliss and love to me. I saw it, and I just said, wow. And after a little while, I said, that's too much, it's too much. Too can't take that. It's so intense, so pure. The intensity of this purity is too much. And I kind of said, oh my gosh, what do I do? How do I dull the intensity? And so what I did was, what I always do is I jump back into visual arts and music. All right. Now, so let's take a look at this in our little talk here, starting out before we do some practicing. And I spent a whole day of intense effort to do the most cool visual arts and music combinations possible. I have some very cool stuff. And I got it up on the website, said, okay, this is what everybody is good for everybody. And I knew within me that this wasn't right, but I couldn't stop it because I was panicking. And then I got it all set up, went to bed, boom, I woke up early in the morning and I said, this is wrong. Actually, before I went to bed, I was listening to all this great music, the best music I could find. Best music I could find, to try to find some alternative to this pure oneness. This pure one that I was seeing. This pure oneness, this radiance of love, of clarity, of inclusion, total inclusion. And I said, I couldn't handle it. So, what substitute could I find? So I tried to find these substitutes. Say, well, let's listen to this song. It's a great song. This song, this singer. Let's listen to that. By the end of the day, I went to bed at like 1:30 in the morning or something, I realized that actually all art, including the visual arts of all sorts of visual arts, right, and the auditory arts, music of all types, it, in comparison to the vision of oneness, it's nothing. It's nothing. It's garbage. Not even garbage. It's nothing. You can't even compare it at all. Is not comparable in the slightest bit. It doesn't matter what you're listening to or viewing, or what the sensations are, whatever. It's garbage. and even less than garbage, nothing. And I realized it very, very clearly. I said, wow. I tried to get the very best of the very best of the very best of the very best, best, best. I listened to it. I said, that's just the best, 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 best. A genius artist, you know, just absolute genius. And completely flat, flat. And I said, the real art form that we're supposed to be engaged in is the art form of spiritual exercises. That is the way higher art form, actually, than anything else. There's no substitute for it. And I realize when I'm doing the right spiritual exercise and focusing on it, it brings me closer to the vision of oneness. And that is way more satisfying to me than the very finest arts. You could have the greatest musicians in the history of the planet, and the greatest staging, and the greatest decorations, and the greatest clothes, and the greatest everything in visual arts, the greatest visual arts. Just, well, you take the totality of all the great visual arts that have ever taken place on this world, and they're like nothing compared to the vision of oneness. Total garbage. And I realized that. I had the realization. It's just total junk. Just garbage. Wow. So that's when I went to bed with that. And then I woke up early in the morning. I decided, I'm going to remove it from the website. You know, it doesn't do anyone any good, actually, at all. It really doesn't. It doesn't do the good that we think. All it does is it feeds our laziness. We think there's a way to avoid the continuity problem, instead of solve it. So all that stuff, visual arts and music, gives us an excuse to avoid spiritual practicing. Now, I went off that way back in 1995, 96, or 90, back then, when I had done like 15 years plus of A Course in Miracles, tremendous study, and was really, really, really aiming for a breakthrough. And because I didn't understand the continuity problem properly, I got into the clutches of the muse, I call it, the goddess, the muse goddess, the goddess of visual arts and music. And I went into that totally for, you know, another 15 years period, actually. About a 15-year period where I was completely aimed to put on the greatest show ever on the planet, really. The greatest costuming, greatest music, the greatest staging, everything, complete in the visual arts. I made the coolest stuff ever. That I've never seen anything so cool. And it was like, I said, that, you know, we can do this, we can do this, we can do this. So 15 years of being sidetracked because I didn't understand the continuity problem. And didn't work on it. I thought that it was too strong. I couldn't overcome this barrier or something. So over the last several years, I've been able to free myself more and more and more from that. Even now, though, I still go back to it and think, wow, look at this incredible visuals that I've made and incredible music. I put them together. And even if you use like a great teacher like Ramana or Jesus or Ananda Maima in the visuals and everything, even that is still garbage. It's still garbage, I'm telling you this. And they would tell you that too, for sure. And you could make the most incredible, sort of seemingly multi-layered stuff with this beautiful, incredible modern music that uses all this, you know, ability to produce incredible sounds. And it, again, is nothing but just garbage, less than garbage. Compared to actually doing the spiritual exercises. So there is this difficulty, which is the continuity problem, which is why I'm emphasizing this, having been burned by it so extremely badly. Once when I was about 12 years, when I was younger, and I couldn't get people to turn towards what I was seeing as true because of the continuity problem. And then again, when I was older, middle-aged, couldn't quite make the breakthrough with A Course in Miracles, and then jumped back into trying to make the world's best, you know, artistic sort of experience and offering to the world, thinking that that would somehow get us through the continuity problem. It doesn't. It doesn't get us through the continuity problem. And I've never seen anybody get through the continuity problem that way. All right. So it's a waste of time, actually. It's a huge waste of time. But I understand it, that at any point you can flee back into whatever you're used to doing that you think is a substitute, or the ego tells you this will work, don't worry about the spiritual practices, they're too tough, this will work for you. At any point in time you can go back to that. And usually when I do a taping, after the taping on such a high, a spiritual high, I go back in and I feel like, oh, I need to listen to some music. I need to come down from it. and that's how you come down from it. You come away from it. So this is will be a continuing problem for everybody, without fail, is 2 steps forward, 1 step back. The key is to self-awareness and to begin using your will to eliminate the severe backslides. So see, I caught myself on the very same day and then made changes which brought it back on track, instead of going into a 15-year backslide, which I did before. And who can afford to waste 15 years at this point? Nobody can afford to do that. Now, what about mixing really cool graphics with it? No, it doesn't really work. It doesn't work. Because we're going towards this purity of seeing that which is free of all insideness and all outsideness. Simply the presence, the omnipresence. And this is indescribable purity, isn't it? Indescribable incorruptibility, indescribable. Any attempt to depict it or describe it is garbage. Just garbage. And we have to come to look at this and begin to accept it gradually. I know it's difficult. I even said last night, I was listening to George Jones, who's so ridiculously talented as a singer, just a complete ridiculous genius at it. And I had to say, George, it's just garbage. What you're doing is just garbage. That was a tough one. but it is. It's just garbage. For me, that's my favorite artistic expression, because it has all the super, super genius studio musicians, the great recording atmosphere of the 50s and 60s with the tubes, okay, the compression tubes, vacuum tubes, going to magnetic tape, the whole thing. It got super smooth depth to it, super smooth depth. And so you think, maybe this is like the Vision of Oneness, and the smooth tastefulness of it all. It's just like, wow. But after having a glimpse of the Vision of Oneness, glimpses of it, it's nothing but garbage. Unfortunately, I have to say that. So at some point, your very favorite art, you will have to come to the realization, it's just garbage. It's not worth anything. Same thing with nature. I put up some some of the most beautiful video of nature. And it too is just garbage. It's just completely flat. And there's just this total real lack of depth. All the qualities in the Vision of Oneness are absent. Why? We're perceiving and hearing senses with our senses. Our senses give us garbage. Less than that. Actually give us nothing. We're listening with our ears, looking with our eyes, we're seeing all this stuff. The Vision of Oneness comes to us as a presence. Sort of an intuitive presence. It's hard to describe, but we're seeing with the mind. Okay, we're perceiving it with the mind. So I'm aware that everybody has the same problem. Everyone has a continuity problem. No exceptions. We all have a continuity problem, and it bites us continuously and keeps us turning back to the ego, saying, "Ego, what do you have for me? I'm a little too nervous. You know, what do you have for me?" And the ego will say, "Oh, I got this great stuff for you." And you'll say, "Yeah, I like that. That's nice music," or whatever. Meanwhile, you're not practicing what you need to practice, which is to align the overall expectations towards a vision of oneness. It's an alignment issue. It's a turning your valuing towards a vision of oneness, aligning your expectations of what is it that you're going to experience. That is a soft landing into the vision of oneness, which is in turn a soft landing back into the awareness of reality as it is. So by doing these spiritual practices, it's actually aligning, it's an alignment that is taking place. We say this moment as it is totally free of all specialness. This is one of the root practices. We say, I have a very severe continuity problem, and this moment just as it is, this moment just as it is totally free of all specialness. Immediately, I feel a response from that, like boom, a gong has been struck. So there are various intensities of practice, and I'll have to become adept at all of them. I'm not going to try and sort them all out at this point. You know, I probably could, but it's just basically looking at the things and the thoughts you have, and then stating the new expectation you have of all these things. This start out with a plant here, and you say this, and you have to work at it at first to get it going. You say this plant as it is totally free of all specialness. This table as it is totally free of all specialness. And this is a very beginning type of practice, but again, all of the practices actually carry sufficient weight to realign our expectations. This plant, as it is, which has neither inside nor outside, is totally free of all specialness. This table, this rootless table, as it is totally free of all inside and outside. Or we say, this rootless table, as it is, free of all insideness, free of all outsideness, is totally free of all specialness. And then we can go back to saying the simpler one, this day as it is totally free of all specialness. So what I find is you have to have fallback positions in your practicing, otherwise you're going to get discouraged and thinking you're not good enough at it. So the fundamental fallback position from all discouragement and awkwardness, you may be stumbling, like, I can't quite get that. You go back to, I don't have a practice problem, I have a continuity problem. My only problem is that I have a continuity problem. The vision of oneness is the only value. Only the vision of oneness has value because it solves the continuity problem. There's not two visions of oneness, there's only one vision of oneness. There's only one. The one and only vision of oneness, that alone has value. The practice problem has no value. The life problem has no value. The safety problem has no value. Whatever, it says no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. I have a severe continuity problem. And simply this this day as it is completely free of all specialness. So I'm trying to establish some fallback positions is what's important here, is what I'm looking at. And I didn't use those yesterday. I was so panicked, I didn't use the fallback positions, and then it just, the momentum kept me going and going and going. So the sooner you can use the fallback positions, the better. What I found is that this place as it is totally free of all specialness. This day as it is totally free of all specialness. That can be used everywhere. I've tested it out in places where you get distracted and knocked out. And even in church, I was able to use it. You have to remind yourself to use it. And you may not be able to go much further, but it's important to use that. And I have a severe continuity problem, that one too. My only problem, you may like have forgotten your practice, and you say, oh my gosh. you're getting sucked into the egoic patterns. Just say, I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Okay, I don't have an ego problem. I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. The ego problem has zero value for me. None. It has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Okay, you recenter around your purpose. Okay, your aim. You've lost your aim. You've lost your aim. Lost your mark. They say sin means to miss the mark. You've lost your mark. You can't forget. You can't remember. Say, oh wait, I have a severe continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. The vision of oneness is the resolution to the continuity problem. So, and only the one and only vision. There's only one. Center yourself back into that. Then, how do you get started practicing? You may have a lack of spiritual will, which is what happens when the ego gets a hold of you. You lose your spiritual will, and instead you're being entertained. You say, this day, as it is totally free of all specialness. This plant, as it is totally free of all specialness. This walkway, as it is totally free of all specialness. This group I'm with, this group is, as it is totally free of all specialness. And then another, if you have a problem, you can say, the power of decision is mine. The power of decision is mine. I have the power of decision of what I will see. I have the power of decision of what I will value. I have the power of decision is mine. The power to decide what to value is mine. The vision of oneness is my one and only value. All right. So we're developing these basic fallback positions. The more we develop these, the easier it is to push the momentum towards a vision of oneness in various ways. But for sure, you're going to have a backlash. Whenever you do any sort of practice, you will have a backlash. I've never had a time when there has not been a backlash. Because you're feeling uncertain. And again, the central dynamic of the problem is once you look at the ego carefully and you say, oh my gosh, I don't want that at all. Then you start saying, well, what else is there? And you start being a little jittery. And you feel like, well, something's wrong. I mean, something's wrong. Why do I feel jittery? And then the ego will say, well, maybe you're looking at the ego is not correct. And then you start thinking, oh, okay, maybe I'm crazy. They're looking at seeing this thing that way is not right. And then you start going into confusion, insecurity, doubt, doubting the Holy Spirit, all this stuff. Whereas the Holy Spirit can show us very clearly what the ego's about. But then we say, oh my gosh, I don't want the ego. I want to drop it right now. We're afraid of, well, what, for what? Vision of oneness. Well, the purity is too frightening for us yet. We're not quite ready. And we say there's a problem, and we don't identify it as the continuity problem. And so then we misidentify it. So I'd say the most important problem to identify is the continuity problem. That's the root of it. And once you do that, then it stops the misidentification that the ego is trying to get you, hook you into. Once the ego hooks you into misidentifying what the problem is, then it will hook you into entertainment, hook you into various things, even though it dresses them up, it packages them. Here's a question for you, a little test. Let's say there's a Christmas tree, it's Christmas, and around, well, not everybody celebrates Christmas, I understand, but the analogy will stand here, is that you have, let's say, 250 presents around the tree, just a massive pile, and every single package is packaged in incredibly beautiful style, with lovely paper, bows and ribbons and tassels and ornamentation. I mean, just the presents look like $1 million. So you take the first package and you say, wow, this is incredible, it's so precious. And you cut the ribbon, you take everything off, the open, cut the paper, you know, and inside is a little box that looks, you know, one of these beautiful luxury boxes. And you open up the box and, oh my gosh, it's probably a diamond bracelet or whatever. You open it up and there's nothing in there, nothing in there. And you say, what? You say, someone's playing a trick on me there, that's bad. Then you say, okay, it's 249 more presents. You get another one, so let me try this one. This one has really cool packaging, it's so awesome. And a box inside is really, you know, totally different with, like, you know, beautiful, the way they can make boxes and stuff. Wow, you say, this is, whatever's in here is gonna be great. You open that up and get nothing. Do some more. And meanwhile, your spirits are starting to sink. You said, I thought I was going to get this incredible bonanza here with all 250 presents. And so far, I've gotten nothing. And you're starting to feel really confused and like shaky and nervous. Like, what's going on here? Okay, here's the question. How many more presents do you open once you've gone through 15, 20 presents, all nothing inside? How many more presents will you open? Now, the ego will tell us that it's a test. Is, can you locate the one present that has the value in it? Okay, that's what the ego's telling you. It'll tell you that, but you just haven't found the right one yet. It's a scavenger, some kind of, you know. So it wants you to keep opening presents, telling you that in one of these presents there's this super great value. But let me share the answer to this test here. Is what the ego, the present that the ego wants to give you is your own death, okay? And it wants to drive you into death through despair. And you see this, the ego cannot kill the spirit. But it thinks that spirit can kill itself, commit spiritual suicide. And once spirit is dead, the ego doesn't have to worry about having spirit withdrawing its projection, which is what the ego is. Insane magical belief on the ego's part, because it would disappear too, but it can't figure that out. It thinks that it's separate will, but it just has some sort of weird, we have some sort of weird power over it. It's got to break that power, then it'll experience its separate existence. The good news is spirit can't kill itself. It's not the will of God that spirit could destroy itself, because what God creates is the totality, and if any, the totality cannot die, cannot kill itself. There isn't any will for any destruction of the totality. So the ego wants you to do is it wants you to keep opening presents and keep being falling into despair. And it will play this game in some way with you. So the secret is to stop opening the presents. Because again, the ego says there's a gift there. But what the ego is really saying is its gift is there. Its gift is there. And its gift is your eternal death. And it thinks that if you keep opening those presents, at some point you'll be so full of despair that you'll want to kill your, you know, you want the spirit to just die. Which it is true. Ego got me to such a point where all I wanted to do was die. Every day I said, how come I'm not dead? I just want to die. It's just I couldn't die. My spirit couldn't die. So, and it kept it up. It can. It's ruthless in this regard. What it does is it finds out what you're attached to, or what kind of form that you're attached to, and then it promises you that form, okay? And it makes you go on a wild goose chase for that form. So I'm going to get you what you want, whatever it is you want, form based on. Yeah, but you just have to do this first, or this, or it's coming today. So the ego promised me all these various things that I thought I wanted. and never delivered on them. And what I found was, it was trying to drive me into despair. It was trying to drive me into despair. Here's another example. Let's say you're going to get married, and your future spouse, you have all the relatives invited, all the expense, you've gone spared no expense, you have this extravaganza, the most incredible music is there, the decorations, the food, the atmosphere, the location, everything is awesome. And the day comes, and you walk down the aisle first, all right, and you get to the altar, and now they say, now we're going to call the spouse up. For some reason, they do it that way. And they call the spouse, and the music begins. And you're waiting, it's like, okay, where are they? Where are they? This is great, everybody's so expectant, this is the big moment, you know. And you wait, and you wait, and they call the spouse, okay, there's some little late or something, what's going on? You wait, and the spouse never shows up. Everyone says, oh, they got cold feet. And you're like, you're crushed, absolutely crushed. It's the most embarrassing, crushing thing imaginable. And you say, wow. And so then you go talk to the spouse or whatever. And in this case, the ego says that they have the spouse for you. And the ego will say, well, things weren't quite right. You didn't quite have things right. Your heart wasn't really in it. Okay, you need to put your heart in a little more. You got to believe in a little more. You say, okay, I will. You go through the whole thing, everybody apologize to everybody and say, look, I'm sorry, but we got this set up right. Now the ego says, yeah, you got it set up perfect. And you do it again, the whole thing. Again, you're waiting for the spouse. The spouse never shows up. Now you're just like doubly devastated, you know. Now imagine if you went through that, how many times did you go through that? 1,000 times or something. I've been through this thing like thousands of times, something similar like this. Over and over and over, and you just get so incredibly crushed and embarrassed. Now, the ego found out that I thought Anandamayi Ma was just the greatest teacher, example of bliss, and she was for sure. And as long as Ramana Maharshi also great, you know, just this unbelievable purity of perception. Of, you know, just absolutely pure perception. And the ego said, guess what? She's coming back. She's coming back to the world. You'll get to see her. Well, as soon as the ego found out, you know, the ego may have pointed her out to me. I don't know. But knowing that I would have got this reaction. And the ego says, she's coming back. And you get to set up the preparation for this and help everybody, you know, introduce everybody to her. And so the ego spun this tale for me. And so I said, wow, I believed it. And I had a lot of reinforcement of it in dreams. And so I thought that for sure she's coming back to help the world. Why not? And so I just spared no expense to prepare for this. And the ego, every day the ego said, you're going to see her today. She's here and you're not quite ready for it. You have to do a little more preparation. So literally every day I would prepare to this most extreme extent of what more can I do to put on this tremendous worldwide campaign, you know, to help the world out. And every day, nothing. And then I'd say, what happened? What? And then I get the responses, you didn't quite have your heart in it enough. So you got to put your heart into it more. Well, obviously, the more you put your heart into something, the more heartbreak there is when it doesn't happen, right? And so I went through this every single day of my life. I thought for sure, if I just went all out today, and spare no effort or expense or just and put my neck out, that would be enough. Nothing ever happened. And I just wasted 15 years of my life on that. And the whole time I was just like crushed, absolutely crushed, and I felt like it's just the most crushing, just totally dispirited. Why? That's what the ego wants. The ego wants to dispirit you to the point where you commit spiritual suicide. And the ego thinks that if it promises you that some great teacher is coming back and that you expect it and you think that you need to do something to make it happen, that's a great way to crush your spirit. A great way to crush your spirit. And it is. I mean, I felt just utterly demoralized, dispirited, and just, you know, super disappointed in myself and in God and in everything. And I said, you know, even God doesn't care about us. You know, this is just it's incredible. It just crushes your spirit. This is how the ego works. The ego promises you, promise, 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 in terms of that you need to do something to save the world, as it were. Okay, and then it's all on your shoulders. You failed. You failed. It didn't happen because you didn't put in enough effort. Your heart wasn't in it enough. And the ego hopes if you just put your spirit into it entirely, then when it doesn't happen, your spirit will just collapse and just die. Or you want to just, you know, destroy yourself. You're so distraught, you know, mortified, so embarrassed. And I felt I let everybody down. And I promised people so much it was, and it turned out to just be not true. And I felt, you know, just this mortal, you know, shame and embarrassment, and thinking that I thought that this is what happened. I told people it happened, and it never happened. And you lose all credibility, you know, all this stuff. This is all the ego. The ego is tricking you in all of this. It's intentionally bringing all this stuff about in your life to try and get you completely despondent. And feeling you're worthless, that you're incapable of doing what you need to do. You've let the whole world down, and you should just die. Your spirit should die. That's its game. That is the ego's game. There's not some other game that it's engaged with. So it targets everyone. It's a miracle I'm still alive. I've been so distraught, you know, over my lack of success, lack of ability. I can't seem to get any help for the world. But it's the ego that's sponsoring that. Now, the truth of the matter is that when Jesus left the world, he said he was coming back. That's what they said he said. And it's true that every single generation since then has believed that Jesus is coming in their generation. All the apostles, okay, believed, well, I would say, I don't know anything didn't, but they believed that Jesus was coming back in their time. I mean, Saint Paul sure believed it, didn't he? he was running around telling everybody, get ready, because this is the end of the age. The Romans are going to come and destroy, you know, Judea, and you got to be ready, because this is it. He's coming back. All the Christians were in the state of total, you know, super preparation readiness for Jesus to come back. Didn't come back. Every generation since has been in this state of fervor, you know, and it goes through cycles, become very full of fervor that Jesus is coming back. And then when it doesn't, it's like people just collapse. You see all these millennial groups who think this is it, here's the rapture. It doesn't happen. They get crushed. Just crushed. It's crushing. I've been through that too. Of people promising that the rapture is going to happen, or there's some great event, and it doesn't happen, and you feel just like, wow, this is just you feel like this. You want to die. You know, it's terrible. So I try not to set any hard dates for any particular thing to happen. I found that is not a good idea. It is a good idea to keep positive pressure on yourself, because there's no question that the world is turning into a personality cult. That is true. There's no question that this is the end of the age. I believe it most certainly is. But what is going to happen at the end of this age, I don't know exactly. And I don't know for sure if Jesus is coming back. I don't know for sure if any guru or great teacher is coming back. And I don't know any date that they would come back. I do know the Holy Spirit has told me to be ready by March 17th for some situation. I'm not sure what it is. So there's a fine line between preparing for the end of the age and setting a hard date and thinking this has to be it or else. Because the ego is very clever in trying to drive you into this. Amazing what happened to me. I just, because I had all these dreams of this great guru meeting with me in the dream and explaining in detail exactly what I was supposed to do. I was just completely in awe. This was like just a completely flawless teacher. And that was the time, the time that I actually came across Sri Anandamayi Ma in a store and all her pictures and videos and stuff. And then from that point on, actually before that happened, I had some dreams. But I also had this dream that showed me, this very important, I had this dream in which I saw Sri Anandamayi Ma and the purity of her perception, okay, totally pure perception of everywhereness without any flaw whatsoever. It was steady, completely steady. I saw her and I saw this other woman jump in front of her and seize my attention, some kind of whorish type of woman. She grabbed my attention. So what happened was, when you get your attention on a great teacher, I found that there's this other archetype. The ego throws this other fake teacher, jumps in front of them, and uses your attraction to them and hijacks it. Okay, it's a spiritual hijacking is what it really is. And I saw that in a dream. I said, "Oh," and then from that point on, I was gradually misled. And so it must be that this inner archetype we have, that remember, it's our own projection egos. We have this amazing creativity, and we can cook up a fake teacher that acts in ways that we think are sublime to us. And so we can think we're following this true teacher, but we're not. So it was so convincing, so compelling, and this teacher would come visit my place, visit me in dreams, explain exactly what I need to do. I need to get this. And everything they said, I would go out and I'd find it just where they told me to find it. So I said, this person knows everything. But remember, our mind knows everything. Okay, our mind does know everything, where everything is. The ego is part of our mind, and it is one with our mind. It's a projection. It's capable of simulating things like this for you. So how do you protect yourself from this? Right spiritual practice is the only way. It's the only way. No matter what happens in your life, you just say, whatever. If Jesus is coming back, and you know everything's going to, Anandamayi Ma is coming back, Ramana Maharshi is going to be walking down the street, fine. For me, I'm going to do right spiritual practice. Because you can't lose with that. You can't lose with it. Notice that when this happened, I wasn't doing right spiritual practice. I thought it was the continuity problem had caused it, as I hadn't recognized it properly yet. And so I felt this was an outlet for my efforts. But if you can stick with right spiritual practice, then whatever happens like that, you just say, well, if it happens, it's great. If it doesn't, it's okay. I've got the right spiritual practice. I'm going to abide in the vision of oneness. There's no question about it. I'm going towards that and only that. And I'm not fixated on any teacher. I'm just getting the work done on a daily basis. Very unglamorous, right? Very unglamorous. This day as it is totally free of all specialness. It's unglamorous. You're just getting it done. And I'll tell you this, any genuine teacher will then have genuine interest in you and genuine support, and the ego will not. The ego will not. Man, they may just leave you alone. They may just you're doing fine. You know, the Holy Spirit's the real teacher anyway. So the only sure safety is to actually engage in these reorienting your cognitive overall expectations towards a vision of oneness. That's why Jesus said in the Course in Miracles, if you don't do the practices, you're not going to get it. And he was right. He was right. I didn't do the practices, and look what happened to me. So the ego can take your reactions to a great teacher and then simulate like a body, as if they're talking to you, but they're just reflecting back your own reactions to them, is what I found. And so what was really energizing these dream images was my own reaction to Sri Anandamayi Ma being put in a form as if she was talking to me. But it was really my own psychic projection that was talking to me. See what I'm saying? So we are so caught up in our in psychic projections, in our projections, that we do it just so quickly, easily. That's what we've been doing for so long, is projecting. So we project this teacher as if they are advising us, but it's actually our own projection. It's our own projection. What a teacher will do is say, don't worry about my returning or coming back or anything so much, is work towards a vision of oneness. Make that your sole goal, just work towards that. Because if I do come back, then you'll be ready. If you don't work this way, you won't be ready. You'll still be caught up in your own projections. Okay. Now, what Jesus said, he's coming back at the end of the age, you know, and nobody knew when that was. That's the problem. And I guess he could have been more specific, you know, could have said, I don't know what went down there exactly. But I do know that our psychic projections are an enormous problem. But they're not the real problem, because it's holding on to them. That's the real problem, isn't it? And why do we hold on to them? Because we have a continuity problem with the vision of oneness, where the purity seems to be too much for us. So we have to lessen, we have to work towards a soft landing into the vision of oneness. There isn't any other effort that anyone needs to make, ever. A soft landing. We say, what do I say? This day as it is totally free of all specialness. This day as it is totally free. That roof as it is totally free of all specialness. This day as it is totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. That plant as it is totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. This is a powerful, powerful approach. So you can start out to say, this something as it is totally free of all specialness, or totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. So this is a very simple, easy form to remember. This something as it is totally free of. This table as it is totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. As we practice this with each individual things, gradually we build up the capacity to see, to accept that it's everywhere. This everywhereness, as it is totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. That tree, as it is totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. Now, the old conceptual expectation, the old cognitive structure of expectations, doesn't know what you're talking about. Of course not, because it's based on projection. It believes in the power of projection, okay? Entirely. Projection is perception that we're used to. What we're doing is healing perception. So it's like coming out of a coma. Of course the coma state doesn't understand the waking state. Of course not. So when you say these things, there's part of you that just blanks out. It says, oh, gone again, can't help them, can't advise them. And of course that part of you is the ego, which is advising you about how to use projection. Okay, and it says, they've gone crazy again, I can't advise them. So the ego says, you just wasted your time. Now let's get back to work. Like after I do the taping, the ego will say, okay, you just took a break, huh? Now let's get back to our work and let's make some real progress here. That's what it says. So this day as it is totally free of all inside and all outside. And then we can talk about the vision of oneness and turn our expectations towards that. So this is a powerful practice too. We probably should include that in our practicing. I'll go over a list, just 1 minute. I actually wrote the list for all the videos I made, 55 videos yesterday. And we'll go over some of the attributes of the vision of oneness and practice on that. So I will get that. Now, what I have found, I made all these videos, 55 videos, with beautiful nature backgrounds, and I put them up on a playlist there. I think they're still on the website. I don't know. Maybe I took them off. What I found is it's really too difficult. It's easier if you have some other people doing it. If you try to do it just by yourself, it's quite difficult, really. So it's better to have someone saying this to you, and you hear it at first, and you realize there's some other person here that is doing this. I'm not all by my alone here, just it seems like. So I'm just going to read these attributes off. We'll practice. I did different practices. The peace. The inside free, outside free. Peace of peace. May the inside free, outside free, peace of peace be upon you. Alright. May the bliss that has neither inside nor outside, which is neither inside you or outside of you, be upon you. Oneness. May the pure oneness of oneness that is entirely free of any insideness and any outsideness be upon you who are also totally free of all insideness and all outsideness. May the immaculate forgiveness of forgiveness that is self-sprung and free of all insideness and outsideness rest upon that which is free of all insideness and all outsideness, which is you. May the sublime glory of glory that is one and free of any insideness or any outsideness rest upon you who have neither inside nor any outsideness. May the totally smoothed out serenity of serenity, free of any insideness or any outsideness, be upon that which is neither insideness nor outsideness, which is you. Okay. May the unbelievable calm of calm be that which be upon that which has neither insideness nor outsideness. May it rest upon you. And so I need to come up just 1 second here. Okay. May the perfectly inside free, outside free inclusiveness that is neither within you nor outside of you rest upon you. One moment. All right, I got called away there for a minute. may the immaculate inclusiveness of inclusiveness that is neither within you nor outside of you be upon you. May the pure one identity of identity that is neither within you nor outside of you, be upon you. May the deep, deep gratefulness of gratefulness that is neither within you nor outside of you be upon you. May the inside free, outside free, relief of relief that is neither within you nor outside of you be upon you. May the inside free, outside free, smoothed out, smoothness of smoothness that is neither within you nor outside of you be upon you. May the clarity of clarity, inside free, outside free, be upon that which has neither inside nor outside, which is you. May the fresh freshness of freshness that is neither, that has neither insideness to it nor any outsideness to it, and that is neither inside you or outside of you, be upon you. May the effortless abidance in abidance, free of all inside-outsideness, and that is neither within you nor outside of you, be upon you. May the one eternal life of eternal life perfectly free of any insideness or any outsideness, and that is neither inside of you nor outside of you, be upon you. May the endless blessing of blessing, self-sprung free from any insideness or any outsideness, and that is neither within you nor outside of you, be upon you. May the inside free, outside free, grace of grace rest upon the inside, outside, free you. May the pure spontaneity of spontaneity, totally free of any insideness and totally free of any sideness, and that which is neither inside of you and that which is neither outside of you rest upon you. May the holiness of holiness of holiness of holiness of holiness, free of all inside outness and that which is neither, being that which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, rest upon you. May the effortless vision of vision, which has no insideness to it that has no outsideness to it, and that is neither inside of you nor outside of you, rest upon you. May the spontaneous freedom of freedom, resting free of all inside-outsideness, and that which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, rest upon you. May the love of love of love of love of love, having no inside-outsideness, and which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, rest upon you. May the perfectly pristine purity of purity, having no inside quality, no outside quality, and which is neither having any inside quality with you or any outside quality with you, rest upon you as it is, as it is, as it is. May the vast and pure spaciousness of spaciousness, abiding in the inside-outside freeness of pure spaciousness, and which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, be upon you. May the silence of silence, beyond all understanding, free of any insideness and free of any outsideness, and which has no insideness within you and no outsideness with you, rest upon you. May the inside free, outside free, stillness of stillness as it is, and as it is, which has neither inside, which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, be that which is upon you. May this inside free and outside free, beyondness of beyondness, be the beyondness that is neither inside you nor outside of you. May the inside free, outside free, total wordlessness of wordlessness, which is neither inside nor outside of you, rest upon you. May the light of light, spontaneously free of all insideness and all outsideness, be the light of light, which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, and may it rest upon you as it is, as it is, as it is. May the inside outside free self-sprung divinity of divinity be the divinity which is neither inside you nor outside of you, and may it rest upon you, rest upon you, rest upon you. May the natural effortlessness of effortlessness that is effortlessly free of all insideness and effortless free of all outsideness be the effortlessly free effortlessness which is neither inside you nor outside of you, and may it rest upon you. May the endless boundlessness of endless boundlessness that has no inside or outside to it be the endless boundlessness of endless boundlessness, which is neither inside you nor outside of you. And as it is, may it rest upon you. May the inside-outside free heart of heart be the heart of heart that is neither inside of you nor outside of you, and may it rest upon you. May the inside free, outside free, immaculate centeredness of centeredness, without any other, be the centeredness of centeredness that is neither inside you nor outside of you. And may that centeredness of centeredness, free of all inside and all outside, rest upon you. May this sublime assurance of assurance, may the sublime assurance of assurance, free of all inside-outsideness, be the sublime assurance of assurance, which rests upon neither the inside of you nor the outside of you, but upon you. May the most welcome carefreeness of carefreeness, devoid of any inside or outside, be the carefreeness of carefreeness that is neither within you nor outside of you, and may it rest upon you. May the inside-outside free, pure, pure presence of presence be that pure, pure presence of presence, which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, but rests upon you. May the crystal clear, inside-outside free beauty of beauty be the crystal clear beauty of beauty, which is neither within you nor outside of you, but resting upon you. May the great good fortune of the everywhereness of everywhereness. Inherently free of all insideness, inherently free of all outsideness. Be the one everywhereness of everywhereness. That is, resting upon inside, outside, free you. May the pure immediate now of now, that has no inside or outside to it, and that is neither inside of you nor outside of you, may that now of now rest upon you. May the inside outside free eternity of eternity be the eternity of eternity that is neither within you nor outside of you, but rests upon you. May that effortless timelessness of timelessness be the timelessness of timelessness that is resting neither inside of you nor outside of you, but is rest the timelessness of timelessness that is resting upon you. May the ineffable formlessness of formlessness, that is, without any insideness or outsideness, rest upon that which is, rest upon you who have no insideness nor outsideness, and may it rest upon you as the formless formlessness. May the ever sublime sweetness of sweetness, which is totally devoid of any inside sweetness or any outside sweetness, be the sweetness of sweetness that is neither within you nor outside of you, but rests upon you. May the all-embracing security of security that is inherently totally free of all insideness and totally free of all outsideness. Be that security of security that is neither inside you nor outside of you, but rests upon you. May this great belonging of belonging that is inside outside free and which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, be this great belonging of belonging that rests upon you. May the evanescent agelessness of agelessness. Standing free of insideness, standing free of outsideness, and which is neither inside you nor outside of you, be this agelessness of agelessness that is resting upon you. May the perfectly apparent endlessness of endlessness, inherently free of insideness or outsideness, and which is neither inside you nor outside of you, rest upon you. May the inside-outside free incorruptibleness of incorruptibleness be the incorruptibleness of incorruptibleness, which is neither inside of you nor outside of you, but resting upon you. May that sublime radiance of radiance that is free of insideness and free of outsideness be the radiance of radiance that is neither within you nor outside of you, but upon you. May the inside free, outside free, isness of isness, which is neither within you nor outside of you, be the isness of isness which rests upon you. May the most holy remembrance of remembrance, free of insideness and free of outsideness, be that holy remembrance of remembrance, which is neither within you nor outside of you, but the holy remembrance of remembrance, which is resting upon you. May the boundless compassion of compassion, free of inside-outsideness, which is neither within you nor outside of you, be that compassion of compassion which rests upon you. May the one, without a second, vision of oneness of the vision of oneness, without any insideness to it, without any outsideness to it, be that one vision of oneness of the vision of oneness, which is neither the vision of oneness inside you nor the vision of oneness outside of you, but is the vision of oneness of the vision of oneness that is you. Just a moment here, just sort of just settle into this. there. See, that is getting down to it. Now, yesterday I didn't think I could do that. What I did was I wrote down all these qualities of oneness, vision of oneness, and then attached these, each one of these, to a video, a short 30-second video of nature. And I said, I'm going to let each person do it on their own. Maybe because I didn't think I could do it like that, straight through, like that myself. But when I realized that that's too difficult. Actually, nature is too distracting, to tell you the truth. When you're being distracted by nature, you're visually looking at something. You lose the capacity to focus in like we just did. Talking right now. That was quite something, but give me a moment here. The shock is that I was able to do that. That's a shocking thing. It's just all, I need a little help, which is okay. I had a list that I wrote yesterday for the working on those videos. And, but because of the profound intensity of this practice, the double emphasis practice, I find it is helpful to have something written down like that, actually. First time I've ever written anything down. Oh, wow. Being affected by this. So that was an example of gathering spiritual will, you see. I had the spiritual will to do it. Yesterday I felt maybe it's too difficult, so maybe I get the ego to help, right? And today I realize that doesn't work. You know, I was thinking, like, put some music to some nice nature clips, and then put the, you know, the saying up there, and maybe people can just say that, you know, as they're listening to the music and nature clips. No. You need to gather the spiritual will and make this big push like we just did. Push it through. Don't get distracted by music and nature. Because then you prove to yourself that you can do it. And your will transcends nature and transcends art and transcends, it's a transcendent will. You have the will to choose. Decide for the vision of oneness. You have the will to decide for it. That is what we have to recognize within us. We have the power of decision is within us. Now, I was thinking maybe I'll flounder, you know, going through all this stuff. No, I was able to do it. Well, the reverberation just continues from this. I'm not able to stop it. That's like landing a knockout blow. You know, something's just knocked out of me. I don't know how it was for you, the viewers here. But the effort to do that and to come up with that. It's kind of like, here's a chord, here's an E minor. Now, make a jingle out of the E minor. So I made a jingle. Okay, here's a C minor diminished. Make a jingle out of that. Now here's an E major. Make a spiritual jingle out of that. You know, and so you got to come up with, you know, these variations and stuff on a theme that you're given. That just landed some powerful blow, and I just wow. I don't know what the results will be, but I was told that I had to be ready by today. By the 17th means, you know, on the 16th. Today's the 16th. Be up to speed, essentially, is what I was told. You have to be up to a certain level of speed, certain amount of will. You have to have a certain amount of spiritual will by the 16th. By the 17th, so I have to, today's the 16th, I have to get there. So, this is, now, doing all those videos was helpful in that I had to come up with some phrasing for everything. So it was good practice in a way, but it wasn't enough. I couldn't cop out and say, here you go, folks, you're on your own. No, that's not it. If you want to be a coach, you know, to encourage an encourager, which is all I'm trying to do, be an encourager, then you have to be able to do it, you know, directly like this. I actually got up at like 5:55 this morning and cleaned up the website, said, no, I can't cop out like this. And then went back to sleep and slept till like 11:30 in the morning. Like right now, what is it? It's 2:20 already. And so I got some sleep and then got up and said, you know, eat breakfast, I got to tape. Let's not cop out here. Let's not do any cop outs at this time. Yeah, this practice just there's no going back from this one. This really is not going away, the effect. So really, I would say that after practicing like this, you have to have a quiet period. I would say that all really intense spiritual practice should have like about an hour of quiet meditation after. So how it should go is there should be a period of quiet to begin with, where we're given some instructions, a basic mood of repentance. You get into the mood of repentance first. Then there should be an introduction to talk about the practice of I have a continuity problem, the confession. And we spend time with the confession, and then we spend time with the basic practice. This day as it is, it's totally free of all specialness. And everyone gets very solid into that. And then from there, we go into a more intense practice. And then after the intense practice, spend time simply quiet sitting without any pressure to say or do anything. That's the basic structure I'm seeing. Is not the gong is continually going. So I'm thinking of what to do, what to do. But I wonder if retreats are actually beneficial in that you don't have to do anything. You don't have to go back to the world. So you can just sit quietly, eat a little something and sit quietly. Yeah, that's possible. Some resonance which is not abating. So the key is to don't try to make it abate. You know, don't try to say, okay, I got rid of this. Just stay with it. But don't try to push it further. Once you make like your intense push, I believe there does need to be some intensity in it. In your practice, you have to get to higher intensity, higher spiritual will, bigger push. But then once you do it, don't try to say, okay, and I've done that, now let me power through some more or something. No, no. Because then you're really gonna get the backlash. The backlash will be too severe, and it's going to affect your sleep, it's going to affect your mind, it's going to affect your nervous system. This, by far and away, it had the strongest effect of any practice I've ever done, for sure. This doubling down practice is—it's probably best done in some sort of sitting. Well, you need to be have a lot of spiritual will to do it, and then you have to manage it properly. It's probably best done in a retreat or in some situation where it's a structured situation, so you know what you're expecting and you know you have some time after it. Very powerful. Which is what the Holy Spirit told me. It's very funny. The Holy Spirit has a marvelous way of getting you towards where you need to go, and it's very so pragmatic that you just have to have a laugh. You know, it's humorous, really. The Holy Spirit told me to get a driver for golf, a golf driver, another driver. I said, "What do I need a driver for? I already got one." He says, "No, you need get another one." And get the different loft, different style, okay. So I finally did. And then I used it and I said, you know, it's really good for some stuff, but not for others. Then the Holy Spirit, actually I put it in my bag, I didn't take the other one out. So I went on the golf course with two drivers. I just used one on the course though. Then the Holy Spirit said, look, you see, this driver can hit a power fade. This other one, you can hit a slight left pull ball left, keep it left in the fairway if you use this style. So where you need to go left, use this one. You need to go right, use the other one. Use two drivers. And I said, what? That's too difficult. Yeah, it's making, I don't know, this is, The only time I've ever heard somebody have two drivers in their bag was Phil Mickelson at the Masters. I think he abandoned that rather quickly. And the Holy Spirit said, yeah, use two drivers. Wow. Okay. I haven't done it yet. Well, maybe I need to. Then, because my back's been killing me, I just can't deal with it. I was behind this white truck a couple days ago, and the Holy Spirit says, pay attention to this truck. Because I said, give me a sign. What am I supposed to do? He said, look at this truck. So, okay, we're at a stop light. We start up again, this truck, and suddenly two pieces of metal fall off this truck. And the truck pulls over like it's going to stop and go back. I said, whoa, these two long pieces of metal are in the road. And then the driver of that truck decided they're just going to leave them there, and they drove off. And so for me, two metals in the road, two metals. We call these drivers, they're metal drivers, so two metals. And in my mind, I said, oh my gosh, leave two drivers in the bag. don't take them out. Leave them there. Leave them where they are. Just leave them where they are. And take two drivers. Now, so this is working at the superficial kind of motivational level. I was thinking, okay, I'm going to commit to two drivers. I decide I'm going to commit to it. Let's see what happens. It's very unusual. Then I woke up in the morning asking for a spiritual exercise a couple days ago. And this double emphasis was suggested to me. He said, why not say it twice, the peace of peace be upon you. May the peace of peace be upon you. What happened was, we went to a special service at the Catholic Church, which was being presided over by the bishop. And I'd forgotten I'd seen the bishop once before, but I wanted to go see the bishop. I said, I want to go to a service that's totally presided over by the bishop. So it was. It's very cool. And afterwards, we were leaving, and suddenly the bishop appeared right next to us. And so I was just standing right next to the bishop. I thought that was pretty cool. And I heard the bishop say, bless you. And then someone else, bless you. You know, the blessing. And I think it was the next morning that I woke up and say, Holy Spirit said, why not say, may the blessings of blessings be upon you. May the peace of peace be upon you. And I said, wow, let me try that. And so I started practicing it during the day. And I found it had this tremendous effect and success. I just said, wow, this is super potent. Super potent. It knocks the ego out. And so then I remembered the Holy Spirit saying, you need two drivers. Double emphasis, right? He says, that's how you really succeed. Now, it has a point. I haven't tried it yet. I hope my back gets better so I can try it. Not that I have any money to do it, but you know what I got to lose? I'm on like half time right now, which isn't enough to pay bills or anything. So, but you just have to trust the Holy Spirit. I do, and the Holy Spirit says, "Be ready by before the 17th of March for something." Okay, fine. This double technique is just potent, potent, potent. It's still, the potency is still just full on. Yeah, I can function fine. Talk and everything, but it's still there. Certainly, never before have I used words in that way. And I have to say, I've never heard anybody in my life use words in that particular way. So it's very new territory for me. It just stunned the ego, really stunned. The traditional cognitive expectations were just stunned right there, just stunned. Then expect that I could do it. Now you can't do that. Let somebody else do it. Here's some nice nature videos with some text. You do it. You know? You can't do that. They said, you can't do that. It's too difficult. Just stunned. continues on. Again, never have I been able to express in that way. Now, that's way better than singing some great song, singing well, way better. Like I said, I was listening to Jones last night and I was just like shaking my head. I said, I hadn't listened to him in a long time. And I was listening very carefully and it's just ridiculous how good he was singing. Just totally off the charts. Of how crafty he was with his singing, how smoothed out and talented. But this here is totally beyond singing, totally beyond singing. Because it summons spiritual will towards the vision of oneness. Whereas that singing does not. It summons the will of the personality. Okay, it summons the personality, will of the personality. But this summons a different direction, a will in a different direction towards the vision of oneness. Those other songs, they basically are saying, they're sort of patting you on the back and saying, yeah, life is terrible. I understand. Let's soothe our tears a little bit here with this song. You know, just let's sit in the honky tonk, drink some hard alcohol. And listen to the jukebox, and this will kind of light, you know, it's a little ice cream for us or something, you know, it's like that. But this is totally different. This summons your spiritual will towards the vision of oneness, which is what you really want. We all really want the vision of oneness. So it's a new type of song. This is a new, it's a spiritual art form, really, of being able to do this. Yeah, I tell you, the effect is way more powerful than hearing the best song. I spent a lifetime trying to find the best songs in the world, ever. And the effect of this is totally beyond any listening to any great song, totally. And people, of course, take drugs to listen to music to try to make it even more. This is totally beyond that. It's different. Doesn't have any really relationship to it. It's like the ego is knocked out. I don't know. It is. So in order to get summon your spiritual will for this, you cannot have it compromised and dragged down by indulging in trying to get what you really want through art, through visual, auditory arts, and motion dance, and drugs, and the whole nine yards of what the ego has to offer the flesh. See, this didn't offer anything to the flesh, did it? This practice didn't offer anything to the flesh at all. It was an offering to the spirit. It was offering to the spirit. It's spirit saying, this is what I really want. The vision of oneness is what I really want. So it's spiritual will. The other is spirit saying, I'm too afraid of the continuity problem, so I can't have the vision of oneness, so I've got to make a substitute for it. So let's find the best substitute we can. I have the will to find a substitute for it. That's when you get the great music and stuff. That's not it. That is not it. And don't try to combine the two. Don't try to serve two masters. I've tried that too. I was very good at that trying to use devotional music, devotional art music form. No, didn't work. It can, in the right setting, If it's the right emphasis, there can be some approach along that lines. But it's a very slippery slope. I don't see much success along those lines, although it may be a precursor to later success. There's certain rudimentary, the ability to summon your concentration and focus and will has some carryover, but eventually you have to get into the spiritual will towards the vision of oneness with this higher art form. Effect has not worn off at all. Now, there may be that there are times and places where people do not have such a strong conceptual focus, and they're more emotional. For them, the devotional singing and stuff can be helpful. But in the modern world right now, the overall cognitive structure does have to be realigned to the vision of oneness. There's no way around it. And so you do have to, most of us need this sort of approach. And let the others do what they're going to do. But for us, this is the approach. This is the realign. The realigning has to be profound, not just emotional. It has to be at the highest level of conceptuality, where we're dealing with these concepts of the, you know, the pristinely pure sweetness of sweetness that is totally free of all insideness and outsideness, that self-sprung is spontaneously neither within you nor outside of you, but resting upon you. See, these are using high abstractions. It's not just some emotional devotion saying, yes, I really feel, you know, God, you're great, I love you, yes, I love you. Because the vision of oneness is this incredible juxtaposition and we cannot transfer it back into the abstractions. We have to use our abstractions to align ourselves with it, actually. Still the same. So this is definitely the approach that I'm recommending for most people. It's the approach I recommend. Now, if others want to recommend something else, let them do that, but this is what I recommend. Because we have to abide in the vision of oneness. It is not a matter of feeling love for the vision of oneness. We have to abide in it, or to feel a longing for it. Like, God, you're way distant, you know, you're greater than me, but I have this longing and love for you, a human longing. That is not it. That comes up totally short. We are not humans. We are spirit. The abidance in their vision of oneness reminds us that we are spirit and not a body, not a personality. This is the whole thing. So we cannot make our goal to say, I'm a human that is worshiping God, that feels love for God, and I love other humans and stuff. That's not the goal. That is absolutely not the goal. The goal is a vision of oneness, which is a reminder by the Holy Spirit to Spirit that Spirit really is Spirit. the effect is not worn off. It's like there's a spiritual buzz, you know, going on. I'm like spiritually buzzed, if I can use that term. You might say this is like a spiritual drug, gives you a spiritual buzz, the spiritual practices. But it's not a buzz that we're used to relating to. But we need to get used to it. We need to get used to it because the vision of oneness will certainly give you a spiritual buzz. And you abide in that buzz. You abide in that spiritual buzz of hasn't really diminished at all. Which is a good thing. I was told by the 17th of March, be ready. So maybe this is it, maybe I'm ready. I always am on time. In my life, I'm always on time. Always to the day, or to the moment, or to the minute, or to the second. Someone says, be there at 3:35. I walk in the door. 3:35 and 0 seconds. Somehow, I don't know why. There'll be traffic jams, there'll be problems. I say, no way can I make it. And somehow, I walk in the door exactly that time. It is just really strange. I've stopped trying to figure it out. I even try to be late, you know, just to try and get out of this. What is this? But anyway, got to be ready by this date. And so on this date, the 16th, it seems as though I've reached some sort of state of readiness. Good, because this is a spiritual buzz. This is what happens when you do right spiritual practice. It's not an emotional buzz. It's not a mental buzz. Not a physical buzz. Some other effect. It seems like as if all the cognitive habits to get me to speak and use words in a certain way, get me to express in a certain way, and expect others to express in that way, it seems as like they are like getting knocked out. It delivered a knockout blow to them. I reminded of my cell phone when I restarted the cell phone. It came up December 31st, 1969, the date on it. And I said, you know what, I bet you I'm going to revert back to when I was 12 years old in terms of my spiritual will, which was then still had the spiritual will to try and to express, you know, to others the truth. But this time, it has to be done in some sort of structure, some way, structured way that accounts for the continuity problem. Because people are really busy doing stuff, and then you cannot say, hey, do this practice. And then they'll do it, and they'll say, oh my gosh, I feel this, you know, I feel like I, what happened, what happened, what happened? This guy's crazy, you know, he's crazy, that sort of thing. So you have to do it in a more structured situation with some controls on it. And certainly, anyone who spends the time watching these videos has to have a lot of spiritual will. So they'd have the good sense to get what's going on. Otherwise, they couldn't keep watching them. You know, it's too difficult. So there's kind of a safeguard there. Whereas if you come up to somebody and fit in one-to-one and try to force it upon them, that's when you can have problems. So clearly, you go into a spiritual practice realizing you're going to get a spiritual buzz, clearly. And so you have to drop the other buzzes. because that will interfere. You won't be aware of it. The whole point is to be aware of the spiritual buzz as it is, so you can get used to it. Because when abiding the vision of oneness, there is this really, you know, just this total, smoothed out buzz, as it were. So if you're on some other buzz, like say you go to a retreat or a satsang, and you know you're drinking a lot of coffee or a lot of alcohol or smoking, using pot or hashish or ecstasy or all these various drugs or whatever, or you're feeling a buzz from members of the audience, you know, physical attractiveness buzz sort of thing of people, because some people are dressed in a physically attractive way, they're trying to generate a buzz, and they're thinking, hey, they're turned on by me, that gives me a buzz, you know, they're trying to get turned on that way. That whole thing, you got to make sure none of that is present. You cannot have other buzzes going on. You got to be in the mood of repentance. That means you're not dressing in any way to attract or turn on anybody else. Your mood is not that, and you're not on stimulants, you're not on mood-altering, perception-altering drugs. And you're not there to get an intellectual buzz through argumentation and discussion, which is another buzz, that we go for the mental buzz through, let's argue, let's discuss, let's have this contest of who's using the right words, who's right, is there. That's a mental buzz. Again, that's out too. You're going for the spiritual buzz. And for sure it's there with this technique. There is no question. It is still with me. It's going to hit 85 again today, maybe more. It's like summer, March 5th, 16th. That's when I planted my garden last year, March 16th. I'm not planting it this year. Got no water here. Got no water in California. It's going to be such an insane thing here, believe me. People don't realize. You know, if it doesn't, it may not rain again until December. And who knows, maybe it won't rain again next winter. I mean, it's just a complete disaster in California. If it doesn't rain at all again through next year, and it's dry period again next winter, there's going to be no food in California, really. I think most food, and we grow food for the whole world. You know, they'll be pumping the wells and the aquifers and stuff, but when those get too low, man, forget it. That's it. It's Armageddon for California. We're facing a potential Armageddon for California, folks. I'm telling you, that is true. Really is true. This is a thirsty state, not just the massive amount of people here, but the incredible amount of agriculture here. This is the breadbasket of the world. We grow everything here. And the farmers are just not planting this year. They're pulling up their trees. They're not planting any crops. They're saying, no water for it. What's the use? So, I'm just saying, hey, you know, how can I plant a garden? You know, that's not sending the right message to people. Anyway, today was the day that I planted last year. I remember it got warm at that period, March 16th, and stayed warm. From then on, it stayed warm the entire time, all through March, April, May, all through summer. Just, and it's actually stayed warm, other than a brief period in December. The whole year here has been warm. I'm trying to see if this buzz goes away. It doesn't.